Ta lofa. Manuia lefiafi. Do you understand that? I hope so. Am I pronouncing it right? I hope so. For those of you that come from the Solomons, maybe, from Vanuatu or from Papua New Guinea, good afternoon long you. Are there anybody like that here? Aren't you responding to me? I can see you there. And if you're from Papua, in Papua New Guinea, adorai namo herea mumukani. Now moale bada herea oimai. Nay meeting dekanai. Ta lofa, thank you so much for coming and so that we can share together this evening. I have a very important presentation for us tonight, and for those of you who are listening out in the downlink sites, we also give you a very special welcome, and to you, ta lofa as well. Thank you. I'll be talking about the silent killer. They call him the silent killer. And the reason for that is because he may be inside you and affecting you, but you don't know about it. What do we mean by the silent killer? I'd like you to come with me on an interesting journey right now, and let us talk about hypertension or high blood pressure. What is hypertension and what is high blood pressure? Let me tell you something. It is a huge problem. It is a big problem right across our region in the South Pacific today. And the sad thing is that so many people do not know what it is, that or do not know that they have it. So knowing your blood pressure, dear brothers and sisters, is so important. A raised blood pressure is called high blood pressure or hypertension. Now let's define that word a little bit more, just to give you a little bit of an understanding as to what is high blood pressure, how it is created inside the body. First of all, the heart beats. And as the heart beats, what happens is that blood flows through the blood vessels. And as the heart beats, and as the blood flows, there's some resistance to the flow of blood, natural resistance. And because of the pumping action of the heart and the resistance that the blood feels as it travels down the blood vessels, these two important factors generate what we call blood pressure. You understand? Okay, the blood pressure needs to be controlled at a very close level. It must not go too high, it must not go too low. It must be kept at the right level. Now we use a special machine called a sphygmomanometer. Now I'm sure you see doctors doing this, eh? Who has been to the doctor lately checking your blood pressure? Put your hands up if you've done that. Okay, there's only a few. I bet you there are people here with high blood pressure who do not know that they have high blood pressure. Ah, now you better think about it. Go and have a check, all right? So we doctors, nurses, we use this machine, as you can see up on the screen there. We put it up here in the arm and we get the blood pressure. Now the reading comes back and it gives a reading. If you look in your paper, they always write it down as a number on the top and then a line and a number at the bottom side, at the bottom. Do you recognize that? Okay, so there's 120 at the top, and there is 120 over, what does it say here? Over 80. Okay, the 120 is the pressure that is generated when the heart beats. Boom, 120. And when the heart rests, the blood pressure comes down to 80. That's the normal blood pressure. But listen to this, because this is very important. That's the upper limit of normal. You get it? Are you listening to me? So that if your blood pressure goes up 125 or 113, You have a problem. You are sitting on dangerous grounds already. It has to be 120 over 80. Now we talk about a range. So 90 over 60 to about 120 over 80, that's the normal range of a normal blood pressure. Okay, normal blood pressure range. Now, as doctors and nurses, we have a special name. We have special names for the top figure and for the bottom figure. The top one we call systolic blood pressure. The bottom one, we give it a name, diastolic blood pressure. Now, you don't need to remember that. I'm just sort of saying, you know, some complicated words just to not impress you, but just to say that it's important. Okay. Now, so that is what diastolic means. All right. The blood pressure means systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure. Let's keep going. We're running out of time. And so 120 on 80 is the upper limit of normal. If your blood pressure goes up 130 or 90, you're already sitting at high blood pressure side of things. Are you listening to me? This is so important. This is so important. Okay, let's move on. There is something else that we need to know. How can I know that I have high blood pressure? The only way that you can know that you have high blood pressure is to go to the doctor or go to a clinic and have your blood pressure checked. All right? There's no other way. You cannot say, oh, I'm fine. I think I'm okay. And the reason is that blood pressure, high blood pressure, is silent. With many people, there are no symptoms. They don't complain of anything. There is sometimes just a little bit of a headache. Sometimes they might feel a little bit dizzy, and then this disappears, and they feel good. But they have high blood pressure. And so it is important that you check your blood pressure. Remember, it is known, it is called as the silent killer. It is so important that you check your blood pressure regularly. Okay, please take that advice, because if anything you can remember, please don't forget to check your blood, have your blood pressure checked every now and then, because it is just so important. High blood pressure, as you can see on the screen, usually produces no symptoms. And this means that most people with hypertension may not realize that they have it until a major crisis happens. It could be a heart attack, or it could be a what? A stroke. And you drop. That's what we mean. It is a serious problem. It has killed so many people in the world today. A lot of these people do not know that they have this problem. And so please remember, have your blood pressure checked regularly. Now, what are some causes of high blood pressure? You see my brother there? He's looking very good, eh? He's looking very healthy. Okay, look at him. All right, let's come. Number one. Let's just go very quickly. 80% of hypertension is what we call, as the medical profession, idiopathic. And it simply means that we don't know the cause of 80% of the causes of hypertension. Are you with me? Are you listening? All right, that's important. Remember that one. But the 20% we know. The remaining 20% we know. Okay. And so we can categorize the 20% that we know into two groups. One, as you can appreciate on the screen, causes of high blood pressure beyond our control. All right. And as you can see there, number one is heredity, that it comes down in the family. So if your father is a hypertensive, it is possible that the son might develop hypertension. Or it is possible that the daughter might develop hypertension. Heredity runs in the family. Okay. Number two, race. African Americans, more prone to high blood pressure than the Caucasian population of America. It's genetic. Somehow it runs in the race. And so I have to be careful because I was in New York not very long ago, and I was wearing a cap, you know, and I really looked like a black dude, you know what I mean? And I was walking on the road, and this African-American came and said to me, "Where do you come from?" And I said, "Oh, I come from Africa." "Oh, which part of Africa?" And I said, "From Zambia." "Oh, Zambia. Oh, I've been to Zambia." And then he said, "From what village in Zambia?" And I gave a name, and he said, "Oh, yes, I know that village as well." I've got to be careful. Darker-skinned people, you're prone to developing high blood pressure, so be very careful. As you grow older, blood pressure goes up as well. And so remember, aging is one factor that can lead to high blood pressure. Now, these are beyond our control, but there is good news. And I want you to know and understand this. Even though a person may be prone to developing hypertension due to the factors that are beyond our control, as we have already mentioned, by choosing right habits of living, you can control high blood pressure. You can prevent developing high blood pressure. Now that's very good news, I reckon. And so remember that, because I think that is just so important. Number two, causes of hypertension that is within our control. All right, so under this category, let's look at some of the problems. Lack of physical activity. Now, brothers and sisters in Samoa, and those of you looking and watching at the site, you will be tired of hearing Dr. Kuma say physical activity. But I won't stop talking about physical activity because I believe this is so important for you and me. Look at this. Inactivity, lack of physical activity, is one of the most important factors that leads to high blood pressure. The 20%. That we're talking about now. Very, very important to realize that. Let's move on. Number two, overweight, obesity. That is another phrase that I'm going to be using over and over again. I used it yesterday. I'm using it tonight. And there's some more lifestyle diseases that we'll be talking about, and you will hear it come on again, because all the lifestyle diseases are basically brothers and sisters. And they have one common denominator. And they're all the same. So listen carefully. And don't be tired when I repeat things. Overweight, obesity, big factor that leads to high blood pressure. Alcohol, please understand this. Alcohol is, the link between alcohol and hypertension is well established. Alcohol dramatically increases blood pressure. And we don't have time to go into the details of things, but it is just so important to understand that alcohol consumption leads to high blood pressure. Not only to high blood pressure, but you remember yesterday we talked about the fact that alcohol raises the fat levels in the blood and can give rise to heart attacks. You understand what I'm saying here? Here, it also gives rise to hypertension. So alcohol is a major risk factor to health. We need to understand this. This is so important, so crucial for our understanding. Cigarette smoking, there is a chemical in cigarette smoking. Cigarettes have about 4,000 different chemicals. I'll be talking about drugs next week. So come along, don't miss it. Okay, so this is going to be a very interesting presentation on drugs. But in cigarette, there is a drug known as nicotine. It's this drug that makes you want to smoke every time you miss one, you want to smoke. You know, if you're addicted to cigarette, you want to smoke. It's this nicotine that makes you want to smoke all the time. It is addictive, all right? But nicotine, at the same time, increases the blood pressure, big time. Okay, and so cigarette smoking, one big problem in hypertension. Diabetes. I'll be talking about diabetes tomorrow. Come along and listen to what we can share about diabetes. But diabetes, in a nutshell, destroys the blood vessels everywhere in the body. And because of its destructiveness of the blood vessels, it gives rise not only to heart attacks, but it gives rise to serious high blood pressure. So if you're a diabetic, make sure that your blood sugar is well controlled. Come tomorrow and we'll talk about diabetes a little bit more. But diabetes and hypertension are cousins. They may be even closer than them. Maybe they're brothers. Okay. Maybe sisters, if you like. Call it any way you want. All right. Number seven. Let's come to number seven. Salt. You love salt? Who hates salt? Okay, salt. Very important for the diet. Very good, you know, sodium chloride. You need sodium chloride in the body for many different functions. Your heart pumps because of the effect of sodium, okay, and other electrolytes. But listen to this one, because this is very important. Salt leads to hypertension. People who had lots of salt in their diet are more likely to have high blood pressure. Sodium is a major component of salt and can raise the blood pressure by causing body fluids to be retained in the blood vessels. Okay, sodium chloride or salt raises blood pressure significantly. What's the normal amount of salt intake per 24 hours? Does anybody have any idea? I've got it on the screen, so you can read it. Okay, this is no quiz. All right, look, what's the answer? What's the answer? All right, you can choose to eat less salt. 2,300 milligrams per day is the amount of salt that you need in 24 hours. 2,300 milligrams is equivalent to what? Can you respond to me? Is equivalent to what? One teaspoon only in 24 hours. Huh? What does Samoa do? Huh? One. Maybe two, one saucepan here, another saucepan here, one bigger oven here, and we add salt. We in the Pacific, seriously, I didn't add the figures here, but we in the Pacific are eating too much salt, and it's killing us. I attend a very important, I'm a member of a very important organization in Australia called they deal with salt. Regulation. This is part of the Australian government trying to regulate the amount of salt that people consume in Australia. And every year I attend conferences, and it is just amazing. It is alarming to see how salt is destroying the lives of so many people. In fact, they are even suggesting that salt kills more people than fats. Oh, yes. Are you listening to me? Okay, so listen to this, because I think this is just so very, very important. Now we come to some complication. Now this is a big topic, and we're trying, it's unfair, they're squeezing me to only 30 minutes, you see. But let's try something, all right. So what are some of the complications of high blood pressure? High blood pressure can lead to serious health problems. Over time, if it's not controlled, it can damage the heart and the arteries, all right, in the brain, in the eyes, and where? In the kidneys. In the brain, in the heart, in the eyes, and in the kidneys. Those very important organs in the body. That's where hypertension does its maximum damage. This is so important, very crucial for us to understand this one. So what are the organs again? the heart, the eyes, the brain, the kidneys. That's where the maximum damage is done, oh brothers and sisters. So this is just so very important. When the blood pressure goes too high, the heart has to pump harder to get the blood flowing. And as it pumps hard, you know, over a certain period of time, what happens to the heart? If you're carrying a big load, climbing up the hill, how would you feel? Huh? You feel tired, and you'd like to offload and rest a while. Poor heart, it has no choice. It has to pump against a high pressure, and it works. And it works, and it works, it pumps. And in the process, the heart muscles begins to enlarge. We call it hypertrophy. And as it continues to enlarge, what happens is normally we would say, oh, it's getting big, so that's good. It's developing more muscles. But it doesn't work that way with the heart. The bigger the muscle, the weaker becomes the pumping action. Are you listening to me? And so, for how long this person is having the high blood pressure, the heart is bearing the consequences of it. Heart attack can happen, heart failure can develop. It's so important to know your blood pressure, dear brothers and sisters. And so, the heart is affected. The brain is affected, the kidneys are affected, and the reason for that is because I've written it down in big bold letters there, the arteries that supply these organs are destroyed and are affected. You understand? All right, this is very important. Okay, let's move on. Let's move on. Heart attack, I've already mentioned that to you, so let's just go to the next slide and see what comes up here. I talked about the rusty blood vessel, eh? The rusty pipe, you know. This is it. It's not only fat, but imagine fat in the combination with high blood pressure. Just imagine the destructiveness of this combination on your poor heart and the poor coronary arteries. Oh, this is a story that we must all understand, because it is just so, so important. What about the brain? This is how the brain looks like. This is a real brain. I've handled brains. I'll show you some pictures of brains when I talk about drugs. You don't miss it, because it's very interesting. I've got some stories to share with you when we talk about drugs next week. But what happens in the brain? I'd like to give an illustration here, just very quickly. This is a pipe, and water is flowing through this pipe. But what's happening to this pipe? What's happening to it? Because the pressure is so high, there is what? There is leakage. There is a tear in that pipe. And so water is seeping out because of the high pressure in that conduit, in that pipe. In the brain, exactly the same thing happens in a patient with high blood pressure. Listen to this. Come see this slide. This is interesting. Look at this. All right? Because the blood pressure is so high, a blood vessel in the brain gives way. It pops. And there is bleeding inside the brain. And when that happens, as soon as that happens, there is weakness either on the left side, if the right side of the brain is affected, or on the right side, if the left side of the brain is affected. And it becomes a very debilitating situation. If the person is lucky, he survives. If not, he can die instantly. Stroke is not a very good thing to have. Now, let me show you this picture. This is a picture of the brain where there is a burst of the artery in the brain because of high blood pressure. And as you can appreciate, and I'm going to turn around, apologies. You can see here, this is the brain. You can see right here, this is all blood clot, because a blood vessel in this very important area has burst. Blood has seeped into the tissues of the brain. this person cannot survive this situation. Stroke is a terrible condition to have. Know your blood pressure, because it is so important and it is just so crucial. Now, kidney failure. Because it destroys the blood vessels in the brain, it does the same in the kidneys. And so we have kidney failure because high blood pressure destroys the tiny blood vessels that supply your kidneys. And so if you look there, you will see a nice smooth kidney, which is a normal kidney. But when you look at on the other side here, you see a very rough looking, irregular looking kidney. This is what hypertension does to the kidney, brothers and sisters. It's a real problem. This is not a theoretical situation. This is a true and real problem that we're talking about today. Your retina, which is your eye, hypertension can lead to blindness. On this side, as you can appreciate, this is a nice, clear retina. The retina is right at the back of your eye, and where there's blood vessels there. And if any damage happens in the retina, what happens is you can go blind. Okay, in high blood pressure, what happens is you can appreciate all these problems. You can see there's pus. You can see there's white substances here. There is inflammation. There is all sorts of things happening in there. This person here on that side is blind because of high blood pressure. Now, it is important to realize all these complications, but I think there is one more. Oh, now we talk about the preventions. The preventions are very straightforward. Like as with heart disease, you can reduce your risk of early death from high blood pressure by making a few simple lifestyle changes. Number one, just very quickly now, be more active. Number two, you've heard this yesterday. Number two, avoid excessive salt. Please, listen to me. Avoid excessive salt. Number three, what does number three say? How to decrease salt? Eat more fresh foods and vegetables. Reduce consumption of high fat, high sugar, high salty snack foods. Chips and sweet drinks. You have a very good McDonald's here. Do they ever test how much salt is in the chips they make? Or do you add it yourself? Huh? All right. Now I hope you understand. Not too much salt on your chips, eh? Limit salty snacks such as salted peanuts, salted and fried cassava. Only eat takeaways and fast food such as fried chicken, chips, and all those sort of things that do not have salt. Not too much salt in them. It is so important. Choose low salt processed foods. Read the labels, brothers and sisters. The Pacific, we don't want to read. Huh? If it tastes good, it is what? It is good. That's our biggest problem in the Pacific. We don't want to see labels. Huh? Read labels and see, oh, how many fats here, how many salt here. We don't know. As long as it feels good and it tastes good, it must be good. No, that's not the way. Ah, let's see, there's a few more here that I'd like to share with you because I think this is just very important. Check food labels, I've said. Use lemon juice, garlic or vinegar, or herbs and spices as alternative to salt. Limit the usage of stock cubes. They're so salty. Soy sauce, mustard, pickles, you know, and those sort of things. At the very least, choose low salt variety. I'm talking too much about salt because I know and I have seen salt destroy the lives of people. So important. Ah, Noel, you're ready to come up. But I have two more things here. Watch your weight. All right? Watch your weight. Has anybody started walking early in the morning after our lectures? Brother Noel, I think I better get on the plane. Go tomorrow. Nobody's listening to me. Who's putting the words that you're hearing here into action? Come on, let's start changing habits. Start changing our lifestyle. Because just listening to information does not mean anything. Weigh yourself. Know what your weight is. If it's too high for you, cut it down. Avoid alcohol, so crucial and so important. We've seen the reason. Avoid cigarette smoking, so important. Don't touch cigarettes, young people. If you're a diabetic, make sure that your blood glucose or sugar level is controlled properly. Okay? Don't let appetite and taste take away self-control. And it's the same for all of us, even those of us that don't have these diseases. Diabetes is a major risk factor for hypertension, as well as other major lifestyle diseases, as we have already mentioned. And make sure, please, that if you're on medications, ensure that you're regular with your medications. This is so important. Okay, very, very important indeed. Remember, have your blood pressure checked regularly, at least every 6 months. And for those who have hypertension, it is important that you visit your doctor on a regular basis for blood pressure checks and for advice on your medications. You may find that as you cut down on the greasy foods, you know, and on the unhealthy foods, and increase your health, you know, the plant-based foods, and you go walking, you might find that your weight starts going down and your blood pressure will drop down as well. And so that is one good reason why you need to see your doctor. Because he might need to change the dosage of your medications. Okay, and so it's very important that you have regular checks with your doctor. Do some exercises every day and make healthy food choices. Avoid alcohol and cigarette smoking. And remember, dear brothers and sisters, remember to ask God to help you make the right choices in life. You know what? We have a wonderful Savior. He loves each one of us. He cares for each one of us. He's gone to the extreme to save you. He wants you not only the health of your spiritual life, he wants you to enjoy physical health as well, social health, mental health, and spiritual health. So crucial. He wants you to enjoy shalom. May God bless each one of you this evening. Go home and please promise me that tomorrow in the morning I'll be awake, 5 in the morning. I want to see Apia full of people walking everywhere. Can you promise me that? God bless each one of you. It's been so nice sharing with you this evening.
His love. Fear.
When Jesus is in the life, there's no need to fear. Amen.
Amen.
People who fear are people who need Jesus. And that's what we're doing night after night here. To help people to enter into that relationship with Jesus. I see
this,
the hall is getting full now. Amen. Can we say amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. In fact, I have good news for the young people. For our youth. Can we give some place to the visitors? There are visitors, I heard, who would love to sit. So if there's one or two youth, can displace yourself. We've got a screen outside for you. Please feel free to make your move. Who are those who come for the first time tonight? We see one hand here, two hands. Raise up your hands a little bit. What do we say? Amen. Amen. We're glad you made it tonight. God bless your heart. We're so delighted to see your beautiful face. And someone's have beautiful face.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Bless your heart. You know who gave you that face, no? It's Jesus. Amen. So praise God for your beautiful face. Don't look into the mirror and praise yourself. You might lose your face or else. Thank you for those who've tried hard to bring people. Those who are on their different sides, thank you for what you've been trying to do. Oh, may God bless you. Like we've been seeing a couple of nights, most important thing is our relationship with Jesus. Many things are happening tonight that are important. But nothing comes close to your relationship with God. So I want to congratulate you tonight for choosing to be with us. Last night I was at the door greeting people. And one of the pilots was saying to me, you know what, my friend who's a pilot, he's flying and he wants to be here on time. So he's praying that he will not be late for the meetings. I praise God you made it tonight, my bro. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God bless your heart. We have some distinguished guests among us. If I would mention your name, it will take too long. But we just want to praise God for your presence tonight. CEO, CFO, all those O's, welcome tonight. Amen. There's lots of you. I cannot recall all of you, but God sees you. We saw that last night for those who were here. God sees each one of us. We mean the whole world for God. So don't worry if people don't know you tonight. Jesus' eyes are upon you. That's all you need. You don't need more than that. We're going to talk more about this identity crisis upon the human heart. But let us deal with the topic of tonight. Please don't leave me beforehand, because there's somebody who's going to share his story of what Jesus has done to him. A great man who has been far in the level of education and intellectual. But somehow there was something he did not know yet. And he went through an experience where God really finally revealed himself to him. And today he's complete in Jesus. Amen. He's going to share his story. So please, those who are on the different sides, please don't miss that. Anybody knows this person on the screen? Anybody knows? Well, this man's name is William Wheeler.
William Wheeler.
Not William Miller, William Wheeler.
William Miller, William Wheeler.
William Wheeler was an atheist. He did not believe in God. In fact, he was against Christianity and the Bible. But he was a rich man too. He was a film producer. William Wheeler wanted to come up with a movie to show to the world that God does not exist. He wanted to make the best movie to turn the world against Jesus and the Bible and God. But for him to come up with the best movie, he has to study the Bible to try to find some point to attack Jesus and God and the Bible. So he started to study the Bible. And guess what happened the more he studied the Bible? Finally, he found Jesus in the Bible. He personally had an encounter with Jesus. He was so moved by the word of God that he finally gave his life to Jesus. What do we say out there? So finally, instead of coming with a movie that would turn the world against God, he came with that movie known as Ben-Hur. Anybody knows Ben-Hur?
Ben-Hur.
Can we praise God tonight? Up to now, Ben-Hur for me is the most beautiful movie I've ever seen. In fact, before Titanic, Ben-Hur was known as the movie of the century. That man who was against God. That man who has been trying to do everything to turn the world against God decided to study the Bible. And as he studied the Bible, he came to realize that the Bible is the best book to read. Can we say amen?
Amen.
Tonight I'm going to talk about this book called the Word of God. And we're going to see tonight that the function of the Word of God is to change people's life. You will learn tonight that out of love for humankind, God has sent us the most precious gifts of all gifts. The Word of God. A love letter to each one of you. You will learn tonight that it's only by reading the Word of God, by studying its pages, through the help of the Holy Spirit, we will come to know Jesus and fall in love with Him. Tonight you will learn that authentic relationship with Jesus can take place only as you and I study carefully the Word of God. True relationship with God can take place only not only when we study the scripture, but we put it into practice. It is through this book that the more we study, the more we see the great controversy coming real and alive. And it is as we study the Word of God that God reveals to us what we must do to win over the battle in that great controversy.
The
title for tonight is The Emperor's Scroll. Subtitle is God's Love Letter Written Especially for You. Let us pray. Father in heaven, your people have come again tonight. Those who are on their different sites, all over those 22 sites,
Father,
bless each one of us who have come tonight in all those sites, including here tonight, Father. May tonight, like William Wheeler, we will see your face from the Bible. May you speak to each one of us. May you tell us great things about you. May you change our lives even tonight as we study the Bible, so that when we get out of this place, like William Wheeler, we shall fall in love with you, and we shall start to study the Word of God. Bless this unworthy and but yet chosen vessel. So again, as I speak to your people, it will be you, not me, speaking to them. In fact, I ask you to speak to me too, Father, and grant me the grace to obey your word. Grant each one of us to obey your word. This power of the Holy Spirit. Some of our visitors have left their children at home. Bless their children and their families they've left at home. May we have the best time in your presence, because Jesus is in our midst. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
My dear friends, I want to gain your attention tonight with the parable of the sower who went out to sow.
taitaina oe ile fataoto lo tu spaia ile lulu saito.
Let us read in Matthew chapter 13. Jesus speaks, he says, "Behold, a sower went out to sow." And as he sowed, some seed fell by the hard path, and the birds came and devoured them. Some fell on stony places where they did not have much earth. The plants sprang up quickly, but they soon wilted beneath the hot sun and died because the roots had no nourishment in the shallow soil.
Wapa uisi le me papa e titi le sai ai ona vave tupulea ona ole le ele nei titi waluane le la wavela sia ona mangu mangu ailea ona wale ainia.
And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them.
Wapa ufo isi leva tui tui, watu tupu ai fo leva tui tui, ona fetine ina ina ilea.
But others fell on good ground and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. In who has ears, he who has ears, pardon me, to hear, let him hear.
Awa pa u isi lele, ona fua mai le tai selau inisi, e tai yonu mafulu inisi, ma tai tonu mafulu inisi, o le wa ye talinga falongo ai, ina falongo mai au ia.
I think the parable is quite clear.
Manino lfata oto.
A farmer, a sower, went to sow seeds.
Le lulu saito, walu ato e lulu saito.
The seeds fell on four different types of ground.
Fai tu ai ngai lele na pa u yai.
Only one ground is the right ground or the right soil. What is Jesus trying to tell us this evening? Who is the sower who went out to sow? Anybody wants to tell me tonight? Who's that sower who went out to sow? Anybody wants to try? You're trying to be wise now. You don't want to be wrong. Okay, I heard Jesus here. What about the others?
Fapefenis.
Is it not the preacher sowing seeds? What do you think? No? Notice what the text says. Notice the text says, "Behold, a sower went out to sow." Went out to sow.
Fauta waluatu le tangatas lulu saito elulu saito.
You must understand, my dear friends, when Jesus was speaking to his crowd at that time.
Talano atu Yesu le moto tangatel temilea.
The farms were in the countryside. The farmers were village farmers. They did not live in the countryside where the farms were. Why? Because it was not safe to be in the countryside where the farms were. There were thieves, there were criminals. For example, we see the story of the Good Samaritan in the Bible. You know the story when the Jew was beaten up and there was a Good Samaritan that came to help that person. Well, the Bible says that this took place in the countryside where the farms were. So the farmers were living in their city. A safe place. They will get up early in the morning. They will go out of the city into that dangerous place where the farms were. The cities were well protected where the farmers were living. So, my dear friends, here is a beautiful picture of Jesus himself leaving the holy city 2,000 years ago. Coming down on earth, that unfriendly place, to sow seeds. Jesus left glory 2,000 years ago. He who was adored by over thousands upon thousands of angels.
Lua afeta usanga umuvai na tua Yesu le mamalu silsilio le lami. Pui pui ya angelu mviia.
Left glory came down on earth, that unsafe place where it is full of thieves, of robbers, of murderers. Christ left glory, came on earth.
Na yetu ualo na mamalu ile lami. Aya fio mai le laro langi tumu le onga hoi.
The question is this: what did he come to do? Why did he come on earth? Can somebody tell me? To sow seeds. So the question is this now: what does the seed represent? The word of God, you're right. The seed, same parable, but in Luke chapter 8 now, it says the seed is the word of God. Now, what does soil represent where Jesus sowed the seeds? We're studying the word of God tonight. What does the soil represent? Tell me. People, beautiful. Exactly. Let's take the same parable in Luke chapter 8. Listen to what the soil represents. It says, when they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. In other words, my dear friends, 2,000 years ago, Jesus left heaven, came to earth on a special mission. What is that mission all about? He came to sow the seed of his word in humans' heart, which is the mind, which is the brain.
Na fio mai ina ya lulu ina saitolea yo tato mafofau.
The core of this parable is the word of God. It's the seed.
Ole aunga lea ole nei fatauto.
Many people, they think that Jesus came on earth simply to die on the cross to provide forgiveness. But tonight you will learn that the focus, the core of Christ's mission is not only to provide forgiveness and to reconcile us with God. But he came especially to start doing a work in your heart, in your mind, and in my mind.
And I feel my in a failing alwenga yo to mafofau mota to loto taito tasi.
Jesus came to plant the word in you so that you and I can start living and practicing the truth. Can we say amen? There is something powerful about the word of God. In fact, John chapter 6 verse 63 says, the words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Jesus says the word brings life. That is what we see in the story of creation, my dear friends. That when God speaks, things changes. Everything around us, all of God's creation exists because God spoke. God spoke everything into existence. In fact, without God's word, no one would be alive tonight here in this hall. This is why when somebody meditates upon the word of God prayerfully, his life will be changed. Just like William Willard. Through the help of the Holy Spirit, that person is receiving the very life of God. As a result, his life and his character, they're transformed. I ask you tonight, are you spending time in the Word of God? No wonder why there are so many people within Christianity, they still remain rough and tough. Because they have a name, but they're not spending time in the Word of God. They call themselves Christians, but it's a hard time to see Christ in their lives. As a result, many people claiming to be Christians, they remain the same as they were before they met Jesus. Oh, I tell you tonight, everybody has a Bible. But a few, they're reading it. I tell you, a Bible on the shelf means nothing. Are we all spending time in the Word of God? For Jesus says that the Word imparts life. The Bible, therefore, my dear friends, is a unique book. It generates life. It creates faith. It produces changes in your character. The Word of God frightens the devil. It causes miracles. It heals the hurts. It builds a man into newness of life. The Word of God transforms circumstances. The one who studies the Word of God, it imparts joy to the heart. It helps us to overcome adversity. The Word of God defeats temptation. It infuses hope. It releases power. The Word of God cleanses the mind. And it brings eternal life. Can we say amen? That's the Word of God. That's what the old book is supposed to do in your life. The Bible says that Jesus left glory 2,000 years ago in order to settle the Word and its principle in your heart. Never forget this, my dear friends. It is Jesus who is the sower. It's not me. It's not my brother. Each time somebody is preaching the Word through the power of the Holy Spirit, it is God in action. It is not the preacher. It is He who is the sower. In fact, right now as I'm speaking to you, God is sowing the seed of His Word in your heart. Can we say amen? That's why it is a serious thing, my dear friends. When the Word of God is being preached, it's not about man. It's about a God who is in love with you, with me, who wants to save us. We better take particular attention when God speaks, therefore. It's not a time to play on your mobile phones. It's not a time for you to think about your favorite movie that you're missing right now. It is a time to focus on God. Because God is speaking to you. The parable says that the sower came to sow in four different types of soil. The Bible says, for example, there was the wayside soil. In fact, it's the hard path we just read some times ago. There was another soil, the stony place. Among thorns. And then the good soil. I have a question for you. Why did Jesus sow in four different types of soil? Notice only one type of soil was the good soil. The others have had some problems with it. Why would Jesus bother to sow in four different types of soil? Can somebody speak to me? Why? I see my sister is bubbling up. She wants to say something. Bless your heart, my dear. Why do you think so? Yeah? Raise up your hands and I'll see you. He loves us all. For God so loved the world, the Bible says, that He gave His only begotten Son. God loves everybody on this planet. And He's in the business of trying to save all He could save. You could be a black tonight. You could be a white. You could be yellow. You could be red. God loves you. He wants to save you. You could be a Samoan. An African. An American. You can be anybody. God loves you. He wants to sow His seeds in your heart. That's why you are here tonight. You are not here by accident, my dear friends. You probably saying tonight, I am a very bad soil. I would say, Lord, have mercy upon your soil tonight. But I will also say, blessed be the name of God, because Jesus loves you. He has chosen you for His kingdom. He wants to do a work in your heart. Will you choose Him tonight? Will you allow Him to do this work in your heart? Jesus loves everybody, including all of us who are listening tonight. We have hope tonight. No matter what may have been our past sinful life, because of the blood of Jesus, we all have hope tonight. What does those different soil represent now? Are you ready now? Please buckle up your belt tonight. Because you will see that you will be found in one of those four soils. Like it or not, you're going to be finding yourself tonight in one of them. I'm praying tonight. As you see yourself in one of those soils, don't try to find excuses. Don't try to cover your sin. Don't try to say, it's not me. It's Him. Don't do that. May the Spirit of God lead you tonight to repentance. As you see yourself in the Bible, may your heart falls to the ground and say, God, it's me this day. I need you tonight. I'm a bad soil. I need your grace. I need your word to transform my heart. Can somebody say amen? Let us study the first one, the hard path. All the wayside. Listen, you don't have to bring your own interpretation in the Bible. The Bible interprets itself. Listen to what the word says. Same chapter, Jesus now describes those different soils. He says the seed that fell on the hard path represents those who hear the good news about the kingdom and don't understand it.
Ilatowia. So it ulanga le atoleala. If I longo le upoletua, I le malamalama yai.
And then the Bible says that the evil one, because that person doesn't understand it, the evil one comes and snatches the truth or the seed away from their hearts.
On a sau leolo leanga maavesea.
I want you to notice something tonight. Who are these people? Are these people out there who do not know God or some atheist? Who are these people? Check carefully. I've heard the answer. These are believers in God. The text says, The seed that fell on the hard path represents those who hear the good news about the kingdom. So these are people, you will see tonight that these are all of the four are people who are exposed to the good news of the Bible. It will shock you as we go through this parable. For these people are people who know the word, who've heard the word, but they do not understand it. In fact, they do not even try to understand it. They hear a message at night. They have a problem to understand. They go home and they sleep over it. Instead of asking God, God, what are you trying to tell me? They take it lightly. They say, it doesn't matter. As long as I'm here every night, that's okay. It is not okay. Many people, they go to church. They go to those prayer meetings. They feel so good because they're simply there. So if they fall asleep, they don't mind. They say, because I'm here, God will put a tick in heaven next to my name. Are you following me? That is not biblical. It is true that each time when we come, there is a special blessing for you when you're in the presence of God. But the true blessing is in your understanding of the word. Because it is only as you understand the truth and practice it, then you shall be set free. Can somebody say amen? So I want to thank God for your presence tonight. But it's not good enough. You must understand the truth. And you're saying, Pastor, but when I go home, you're not with me to explain me the truth. The good news is this. The moment you give your heart to Jesus, the Holy Spirit becomes your pastor. Have you heard what I just said? The moment you turn your life to Jesus and say, Jesus, please step into my life. God gives you His Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit starts to interpret the truth in your mind. And as you choose to obey the truth, it sets you free. But some people, they say, no, that's okay. They don't care to understand the truth. And what is the danger? According to the parable. Whoa, listen to that. Then the evil one comes and snatches the seed away from their hearts. Are you following? What do you think happens when Satan comes and snatches that truth from your heart? The heart remains hard. That's why it is called hard path. Because the function of the truth, by the help of the Holy Spirit, is to soften the heart and the character. So in other words, please, don't miss what I'm going to say. These people here, these are Christians who are going to church, some for years, but because they don't understand the truth, their heart remains hard. That's why so often you see people hard sitting next to you in the church. Are you listening to me tonight? They've been in the church for years. The pastor talks about love. They say amen. But they still cannot love their neighbors. Are you following me? Still have a hard time to forgive. The pastor talks about lots of things that you need to give your life to Jesus. Stop judging people. But they still keep on gossiping about people. And yet they've been years in the church. These are these people here. These are hard sinners. Are hard saints. Yet every Sunday they're singing, "Meet me in heaven, we'll join hands together." Which heaven? Heaven is not made for hypocrites. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So these are hard people. They look like saints when they go to church, but they have another private life when they go home, or when they go to work, another private life. My dear Samoan people, it is important to understand the word of God. It's not enough to be religious, to simply go to church. You must identify with the truth, connect with the truth. So that's why even before coming here, don't miss that. That's why even before coming here, there's a work of preparation that must be done with the soil of your heart.
Amen.
You need to pray about it. You need to prepare your heart by keeping it pure. You need to invite the Holy Spirit within you. You need to pray, "God, as I step into this place, let me feel your presence. And as you speak your word, let me understand the truth. And as I leave this place, let you empower my soul so that I can practice the truth. If not, Satan will snatch the truth away. So it becomes something very serious, my dear friends, whenever the word of God has been preached. In fact, notice what the text says. Text says, "Then the evil one comes and snatches the seed away from their heart." I believe with all my heart in that great controversy that we spoke about yesterday. One of the greatest ways, if not the greatest way, Satan is leading people, thousands upon thousands of people, to hell with him, is by snatching the truth away from their hearts. Because you know, according to the Bible, it's the truth that sets us free. It's the truth that saves. Why? Because Jesus once said, "I am the way, the truth, and life." Someone who's truly following Jesus is following the truth based upon the word of God. Today, Satan is doing such a nasty job in the hearts of thousands of people to snatch the truth away from their hearts. And that's why you see, even Paul will say that. Paul says in the last days, notice what he says here, in the last days, there will be people within Christianity that will no longer pay attention to the truth, to the word of God. And by so doing, they will lose their souls. Please write this text for me. Read it for yourself at home. In fact, this is a sign of times. For a time is coming, speaking about the last days, because in chapter 3 he speaks about the last days, and then in chapter 4 he says, for a time is coming when people will no longer listen to right teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever they want to hear. Listen to that. They will reject the truth and follow strange myths.
La toteliliu ese foyo la totalinga ile upumoni aililiwa tu italole babau.
I believe we are living in this time.
Time ile lo tato soi fu
mo lai. People no longer want to hear the word of God, the plain truth.
Tangata wale mana falongo le upole tua male upumoni.
Do you know why?
I share.
Because the truth when it comes to you, my dear friends.
Awa o male upumoni ate oe
oe. Its purpose is to correct your life and my life. The function of the truth is to show us all those different bends that we have in our hearts towards evil. And some people will not like that. In fact, let me read with you what is the function of the truth, the word of God. Paul says all scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives.
Wow, if you ngale tua, if awa wina maitato, mawa wina itato, niyetato lo melo se yotato wolanga.
The word of God corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us what us to do what is right.
Yawa ya yefaton wefa poto inaitato.
God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. You see, the function of God's word is to be a light to our feet, to show us really the defects of our character. We saw that yesterday for all those who were here yesterday. All of us were bent towards this earth. We love the things of this earth more than we love the things, the heavenly things. We love ourselves more than we love God. And more than we love people.
Matagata.
By nature, we saw yesterday, we love sin more than we love righteousness. The function of the word of God is to show us those defects. Can we say amen? Not to make us feel so guilty to the point that we die. No, the word of God shows us those defects so that we can run to Jesus. Confess our sins. Seek for mercy. Seek for a new life in Him. But unfortunately, Paul says, in the last days, people would not want Jesus to sow the seeds in their hearts. It says they will choose pastors, they will find pastors that will caress them in their sins. Pastors that will preach to them what they want to hear. Because by nature, many people, they prefer to live in their sinful life than to follow God. And yet they will keep an appearance of godliness. Many of them will still go to church, even do big things for God, and as a result, because they're doing stuff for God, they will feel good about themselves and their relationship with God. That's why tonight my challenge to all of us is to go back to the Bible. Start reading the Bible. Read it prayerfully. Spend time in it. The more you spend time in it, the more God will reveal Himself to you. Unfortunately, in the last days, many will not spend time in the Word of God. Instead, they will spend time in four unreliable authorities. Please don't miss what I just said. There are four unreliable authorities I'm going to put on the screen. You better write them down. As Christians, we ought to follow the word and not on those four unreliable authorities. There are some good stuff in what I'm going to put there. Let us see them. First one, culture. Culture is a problem everywhere I go in the world.
There are,
please don't miss that, there are some good things about culture.
Since
I've been in your land, I've been blessed by many cultural practices that you do here. I praise God, by the way, for some good cultural practices that you have here. But what is culture all about? It's that mindset which says everyone is doing it. My dear brothers and sisters, we ought to follow God rather than everyone who's doing this thing.
Amen.
It's not because the majority of people are practicing some form of practices, it means it's from God. Like I just said, there are some good cultural practices. But there are some also bad cultural practices. Do you know why? Because culture, it comes from men. And like we saw yesterday, men are fallen. Men are self-centered. Men are sinful. Men are earthward bound. By nature, we are blind. Unless Jesus touches us, unless His spirits fill us, by nature, we are downward. And that's why we cannot really accept everything that culture says. We must filter everything by the word of God. Something else. Tradition. There's some good traditions. But there's also some bad traditions. What is traditions all about? We've always done it that way. Doctor, agree with me. We've always done it that way.
Okay?
Some people, they tell me, what you're saying, Pastor, it makes sense. But we've always done it that way. My dear brothers and sisters, if you love God, you've got to follow God as you follow the word of God. Can we say amen? That's what true Christianity is all about. Some other people, they follow reasoning. In other words, they base their faith and their religion upon their reasoning, upon their intelligence. If it's not logical for them, or it's not from God. It is true that whatever God teaches us, it makes sense. God works through our intellect when he talks to us, when he asks us to do something.
But
to be honest with you, sometimes at first when God tells us to do something, sometimes it doesn't make sense. Because by nature we are blind. We don't see the full picture of God's will in our lives. Sometimes we tend to doubt. We say it doesn't make sense. My challenge to you tonight is this. Even though it doesn't make sense, do it for Christ's sake. Because as you do it, as you choose to do it, then it will start to make sense to you. Behind every instruction from the Bible, there is a promise for you. Behind everything that God tells you to do, there is a blessing for you. So instead of rationalizing the truth, accept it by faith, and it will change your life. It will bring blessings and salvation to you. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? Yes, sir. Makes sense to follow God. There's another one. Emotion. Emotion is a very beautiful gift that God has given to us. We can laugh, we can cry. We saw that in the life of Jesus. But like I just told you, because man has fallen, even our emotions have been distorted. Sin has touched every part of our being. In fact, even to the point that even Satan works through our emotion. That's why we cannot rely upon our feelings. These are those people who says it just feels right, so I'm going
to
do it. No, my brothers and sisters, all these four are flawed because we are spiritually blind. Because we are spiritually bent within our hearts. Sin has marred our nature. What we need is a perfect standard that will never lead us in the wrong direction. And the Word of God is that very thing. The wise man says every word of God is flawless. Can we say amen tonight? Amen. We can trust the Word of God. We can read the Word of God without doubting. Because the Word of God is God Himself. Jesus once said, John chapter 1 verse 1, write it down. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We cannot go wrong with the Word of God. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Let's thank God for our culture. But let's filter though all our cultural practice by the Word of God. Oh, my dear friend, salvation therefore is a principle laid out by God, revealed in His Word. If you want salvation to become real to you, you must follow God's Word. For salvation is not your way. It is not man's way. It is not your pastor's way. It is not your church's way. Authentic salvation is God's revealed way through the Scripture. Can we say amen tonight?
Amen.
We must trust the Bible. It's fully equipped to save us to the utmost, the Bible says. So who are those footpath Christians? I put it right here. These are legalist Christians. Tough Christians in the church. These are closed-minded people who hear the Word but do not understand it. The result, Satan comes and takes away the Word. Hence they remain hard and unconverted. These are hard people that resist to changes that the Word calls forth. Their belief systems is based on rules, traditions and cultures and forms, instead of Christ and His Word. That's why I'm here to tell you tonight, my dear friends, it's not just enough only to read the Word of truth. We are just fooling ourselves if we're just reading or hearing the Word of God. We must understand and practice it. Can I tell you something, by the way? Satan doesn't mind if you come here night after night. As long as you're not obeying the Word that you hear every night. So that's why, what is the most important thing for each one of us? Don't miss that. The most important thing for all of us is not simply to come here and to listen to the word of God.
Oh,
it is beautiful to see this room full. The most important thing is this. What do I do when I leave those doors
tonight?
Am I going to practice the truth? Am I going to obey God? Because this is where your freedom and your joy is. Or else it is all worthless if we do not seek to implement the truth in our very own lives. Can somebody say amen? Second, the stony place. Do you want to know who are these people are? Don't forget, we're not only studying, we're trying to find ourselves in those things. That's the most painful part. Stony place, listen to what the Bible says. The one who received the word that fell on stony places is the man who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. What do you say? No, don't say amen. You need to finish the thing. Listen to that. It sounds good because you see they receive it with joy. But there's a big but. Look at that. But. But since he has no root, he lasts only for a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, he quickly falls away. Are you following now tonight? So these are people who are coming to this building night after night. Mercy now. They're excited, they're joyful every night. But when the pastor goes back to New Zealand, they're off, they've taken off.
Yeah, I fall out of New Zealand,
Mercy! They don't have roots in the Word of God. They're not having a relationship with God through the Word. They're joyful only at first. But notice what will come afterwards. When trouble or persecution comes because of the what? We look all throughout the Bible, my dear friends. We see that all the true disciples of God were tested because of their faith. Today you may appear to be strong and say you love Jesus. But it's only when trouble comes, then you will know if you truly love Jesus. Can somebody say amen? Are you connecting tonight? We can jump and say, I love Jesus and all those things. Who cares? If when trouble comes, you take off and you live Jesus. And this is the problem with those Christians here. They were superficial. But more than that, notice, I want to gain your attention here because it says at once they receive it with joy. Joy is an emotion. So please follow carefully. I decided to put this on the screen so that you don't miss anything. That's my note on the screen for you. Who are these people? Because notice, it seems that they're joyful at some point in time. But then they're off the hook afterwards. So these are those who have a brief encounter with the word. They receive it with joy, but they do not last. Because there is not enough soil. When persecution comes because of the word, they give up. In other words, this is a belief system based on emotion, where those people depend on powerful singing, dynamic preaching, and not on personal Bible study with their God. They have those experiences that will make them laugh, cry, jumping up and down. It is just the impulse of the moment. Are you following? It is a sort of rock and roll system that works the nervous system. But soon after the emotional high is over, things are right back where they started.
Amen.
Are we following here? This type of religion does not change the heart. We need emotion in our religion. But the most important thing is the Word of God. So with this type of system, there may be seeming change under the thrill of the moment. There may be tears of confession. But as soon as the stimulus, that is the dynamic music or the preaching, is removed or are removed, the spiritual life dies out. Does it make sense tonight? Many people fall into this trap. Religion has been something to excite the emotion. But it's not changing the heart. Do you know why? Because only the Word of God can change your heart. Can we say amen? So these are charismatic people. Superficial, surface-minded people who have had a brief encounter with the Word. But they do not continue to dig deep in the Word. Result, when trials and temptations come, because of the Word, they give up. I tell you tonight, my dear friends, if you want to face the trials of life, start building your life upon the solid rock of God's Word and Jesus Himself. And when those trouble comes, you shall not be moved. What about among thorns now? Who are these people? Well, the Bible says the one who received the seed that fell among the thorns is the man who hears the word. So all of them are Christians, notice. But the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. Have you noticed this one? Is it a bad heart, this one?
Yeah,
is it? I don't think so. It is not entirely bad, in other words. It is a heart that has received the word, notice. But unfortunately, in that heart, there are what? Thorns. Whoa! What are thorns? Well, it says there, the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth. So, thorns, in other words, my dear friends, these are earthly things. It can be something positive, by the way. Something not necessarily evil. It can be your education. It can be your wife, your family. You put them before God. Or it can be something evil. For example, the love of money. So this is a heart that wants Jesus at the same time it wants the world. One foot in the church and one foot in the world. Somebody who wants heaven, but he wants the world too. My dear friends, we will never be able to progress spiritually if we want both of them. We will need to surrender all the thorns of our lives. All those sensual, sexual, immoral desires that are against the word of God must be surrendered to Jesus. Can somebody say amen? Do you know why?
I say, Awoy.
Because if you leave thorns in your heart, what will it do to the word? There it is. It chokes the word. So that you cannot grow spiritually. Those very things called thorns in your lives, these are those things that will separate you from your Jesus. That's why, because God loves you, he says, give me those thorns. Because it will affect your relationship with me. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Even your food can become thorns in your life. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
When you put those food before God, finally they become your little gods. So who are these people? Well, these are liberal Christians. They are people, distracted mind, half-hearted people who get carried away with the things of this world. Their heart enjoys, I should not say that, by the way. Their hearts try to enjoy both the word and the things of this world. Because you cannot enjoy both. We will study about that later on next time. So these people cannot progress spiritually because the things of this world choke the word in their hearts. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Does it make sense? Oh, I don't hear anything now. Trouble now. It's hurting you. Woo. It's reaching something there. By the way, I'm happy when I hear less amen. Because I know it's doing the word. It's doing its effect. Praise God.
Amen.
If you don't want to say amen, say praise God. You don't even say that. Look at you. Even that you cannot say tonight. Praise God. Amen. What about the last one, the good soil? Listen to what the Bible says. But the one who received the seed that fell on good soil is the man who hears the word and understands it. Who indeed bears fruit. So who are these people? What does fruit here represent? We will study this more later on. But fruit, of course, here represents the fruit of the Holy Spirit. But when the Holy Spirit controls our lives, he will produce this kind of fruit in us. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. My dear brothers and sisters of Samoa, this is the function of God's word in your life, so that you can bear those qualities in you. Oh, my dear friends, 2,000 years ago Christ came on earth to do a work of transformation in your heart and in my heart. By nature we are selfish.
Proud.
proud,
self-centered.
But when you and I, we start studying the Word of God prayerfully, this is what will happen in your life. You will start to bear the character of God, which are those 9 qualities of the fruit of the Spirit. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
If tonight you've been in the church for years, but you're still selfish, still rough with your wife, tough with your children, still harboring bitterness in your heart, you know there's something wrong with your relationship with God. Because the function of God's word is to transform you. We learned yesterday that sin has deformed our nature. But the function of God's word is to restore Christ's nature within us. Can we say amen?
Amen.
So who are the good soil? These are spiritual Christians. I did not say religious Christians. I'm more careful with being religious. Because you could be religious tonight and still be lost. There was no group of people as religious as those people of the time of Jesus. Pharisees, they were so religious, defending even the laws of God. But they ended up crucifying the lawgiver. They defended the Sabbath truth. But they destroyed, I mean they killed the author of the Sabbath. So don't be proud tonight if you're religious. You can be religious, don't get me wrong. You can practice religious practices in your life. But you must be spiritual in doing so. Spirit-filled in doing so. In other words, if you are a religious people, a religious person tonight, you must be loving, patient, kind, faithful, self-control. Can we say amen? So these are spiritual Christians. Open and receptive minded people who both hear and understand the word. They are willing to obey it. Results, their lives are transformed. They bear the fruits unto salvation. That's why I want to tell you something tonight, please. I'm talking even to my very own people tonight. Please don't miss it wherever you're looking tonight. The word of God has been given to us, not primarily to fill our minds with information, but to transform the heart. Many people are studying the Bible to show how much they are good, how much they can interpret the Bible, how much they can interpret the prophecies of the Bible. Some are even studying the Bible to go and beat up the other religions with. If you do that tonight, you are very sick. Amen.
Amen.
The word of God, first of all, has been given to you to show yourself how sick you are. Amen. That's the function of the word. To point into our lives the defects of our own character. So that we can run to Jesus. Confess our sins. Seek for transformation in our lives. I know many people, they've been studying the Bible, but they're still rough, judgmental, critical, cannot forgive. Why? Because they've been studying the Bible for the wrong reason. I tell you tonight, my dear friends, you want to study the Bible to find Jesus in the Bible. Like William Wheeler. He found Jesus, and his life was changed, and he became more and more like Jesus. I tell you, God's word has been given to cleanse our minds from all sinful impurities. It has been given to set us free from all those bents that we have in our lives. Are you following me? Word of God has been given to set us free so that we can be free indeed to love God, to love people, to love heaven, to hate sin. Amen. That's the function of God, the word of God. John 8 verse 32 says, you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. Are you free tonight? You've been in the church for years. Are you free tonight? Or are you still bitter in your heart? Still angry at somebody? Or even maybe angry at God himself? The word of God has been given so that we can become more like Jesus. I tell you tonight, you are in the shape that you are in tonight because you have put the word of God aside. You're trying to live your life the way you want to do apart from the word. Some of us, we are in financial crisis tonight because you're trying to live your life outside the word of God. Some, you have family crisis tonight. You are in the shape you are tonight because you've forsaken the word. You may have a name that you're a Christian, but are you building your life upon the word? Some of us, we are sick physically because we've been eating stuff outside from the word of God, and as a result we have all sorts of problems tonight. We've been living outside God's word. But let me tell you, my dear friends, as I'm closing right now, God has designed a way for each one to live according to his word. Unless you return back to the word and start to obey the word by the grace of God, you will go down and down in your financial problems. You will go down and down with your relationship with your wife unless you start to take God's word seriously. Your health will deteriorate. I challenge you in Jesus' name to get back to the word. Accept the word just as it is. Stop seeking to compromise with the word, and God will bless you. God will save you, because if you don't follow the Bible, your life will be in a mess. You will get frustrated. You will lose your sanity. You will lose your integrity. Though you may have been up there as a big man in the society, soon or later you will lose your integrity and morality. Tonight God is speaking to you in this manner because there is hope for you, hope for all of us. But are we willing to be serious with the word of God? Like William Wheeler, I challenge you in Jesus' name. Spend time every single day in the word of God. Amen. Can I tell you something? If all of us, we were faithful to the word of God in studying the word of God, I would not have been here tonight. The only reason I'm here tonight is to bring all of you, God's people, back to the word. Amen.
Amen.
If you do that, my mission is done. It will be well only if you start building your life on God's word. James says, so get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives. And humbly accept the word of God, the word God has planted in your hearts. For it is strong enough to save your soul. May we go home tonight with the resolution that we will start building our lives On the word of God. Is this your desire?
Let us stand up and pray.
Father in heaven, as we examine those four different soils, we realize that we are all in trouble tonight. Somehow we have contaminated all different forms of evil soil in our lives. Our heart is not good, Father. We possess an evil heart. A heart that loves you at the same time we want to love the world. A heart that is stony. A heart that is hard. Only you know about our hearts, Father. We don't want to hide our sin tonight. We want to confess them to you. We need a new heart tonight, Jesus. We need your heart. This heart of good soil. Where your spirit could work within this heart. Changes completely. Please, Father. Take away our stony heart. Give us the heart of Jesus. And we invite Jesus to come into this heart tonight. So that you can start transforming us, Jesus. That we can become more like you. That we can be filled with the fruit of the Spirit. And that we can bring light to this dying world as a result. Teach us to understand your word. To seek to understand your word. Teach us to obey your word. And find this freedom that your word promises. Bless each person in this place tonight. Bless each person on the different sites tonight. May we go home with Jesus in our lives. And with the resolution to begin to study your word for ourselves so that we can be changed forever. Give us a good night of rest. If anybody has financial problems, Father, may you help us out. Help that person out. Especially that we can start following your word. Anybody who has any problems at home with the family, Father, please help that person. Save that family. Any person, Father, who is having problems with the health, please do something for each one of us. Above everything, may we follow all the instructions that your word teaches so that we can find freedom and salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.